mechanism. You know, while we may have certain disagreements with areas within this, I think it's important to note the major effort that was done to codify the policies of the library.
Thank you. Mr. Shermer.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the council. I'll try to be brief in my comments. I was charged, when I first arrived, with bringing the library into a formal set of policy documents, the purpose of which is to provide the public, staff, and employees of the community with a written document to inform the public and all interested parties of the way in which decisions will be made which affect library operations, and where possible to designate decisions that have already been made in operating principles. The document that you have before you especially considers the philosophical considerations underlying policies which determine the way decisions are made. In most cases, the policy begins with a rationale or some opening paragraph explaining the philosophical basis for the decisions that govern library usage. In overall terms, the policies are governed by certain philosophical keystones, the first of which is universal access. All of the policies that the Thomas Memorial Library has brought before you tonight stress that the public, in all of its aspects and in all of its members, shall have equal rights and accesses to information within the town of Cape Elizabeth. That in no way shall a public institution be used to support or subsidize private gain, so that everything which happens in that institution happens either as a nonprofit institutional or a civic concern. That privacy and confidentiality are of key importance in today's society, especially a society which is coming to terms with an explosion of information resources. That personal responsibility is an essential use of good citizenship and the use of jointly held materials and property. And that the library cannot serve in its educational mission the in loco parentis role which is normal to the schools. I would like to say a word about the methodology by which the policies were brought to you. We began a year ago by soliciting existing policy statements, manuals, and documents from over a score of libraries in the area, ranging from Lewiston in the north to Wells in the south, including towns as large as Portland and as small as, I guess probably Kennebunkport was maybe the smallest of the communities. All of the documents that we were able to retrieve, we subjected to a rigorous staff review and debate. The staff then formulated consensus policies. We argued those through, or I should say suggested policies. We argued those through until we could achieve consensus. Our approach has essentially been a conservative approach. That is to say, where at all possible, we continued the status quo where it made sense, and we took a middle line where policies ranged across a broad spectrum of responses to communities. Following the rigorous review of staff, the policies were brought to the trustees, again for a period of review and acceptance. The trustees spent 2 months with these documents, reading them through, reviewing them, asking questions about how they functioned, making suggestions, and sending them back for a final revision draft. That is the draft that you have before you. We come now to a stage of council approval. You are the governing board of the town and the only board that can, in fact, approve a set of formal policies, especially policies affecting the use of public property and policies affecting the use of finances and receipt of finances. If the council does approve this policy manual, we will proceed with a public announcement and public relations campaign promulgating the policies, particularly highlighting where policies are divergent or new or maybe unexpected by the public. And internally, we will proceed to underline all of these policies with the day-to-day procedures which make them work. I would highlight for you, first and foremost, in the areas of fines. We have maintained a very conservative approach here of maintaining 5 cents a day. I will tell you that fines range in southeastern Maine anywhere from 2 cents to 25 cents a day. We have taken a very conservative approach. Dollar for videos. You can't touch that in a video rental situation. Perhaps the major change, and a change which has public relations ramifications, is that we are recommending a $35 non-resident user fee. This is high. This is the one place that we are perhaps not being conservative, but we felt that in fairness to the residents of Cape Elizabeth, we had to actually present a non-resident borrower with something that was equivalent to what the town is paying to use and to build its library. Another change that will have some public relations ramifications is the cost of replacing lost or damaged materials. We are coming in at the retail cost of the book. Present practice has been the discounted price. In our review of other towns, we have found that it ranges all the way from retail price plus the cost of processing to $5. So we took what we thought was a middle course to maintain the taxpayer's investment. We are recommending that return postage be assessed to patrons who do not pick up ILLs. I would have to tell you that the cost of postage.
Would you tell people what ILL is, please?
An interlibrary loan, which our services do allow for. If we do not own material, we will make every effort to secure that material from a library in the area, sometimes as far away as California, actually, using the new computerized accessing systems. Currently, the town bears the cost of returning all materials via U.S. Post. That seems to be the status quo. However, when a patron puts us through the process of finding and securing these materials and then does not pick them up, we are still forced to pay the cost without the material being used. So I guess we're putting a disincentive in place. We're taking an extremely conservative approach to the use of facilities. You will notice that there are no room fees assessed. Many communities have moved toward assessing a fee for the use of public facilities and or custodial fees. We are not doing that. Of course, it is the council's purview to make the decision that they do choose to institute those fees should it become necessary. It is our proposal that once these policies are accepted, we will begin to move under the town manager's directive to work cooperatively with the community services in the scheduling of library facilities through a central source. There are no special classes of patronage under the current policies. This is in keeping with my earlier comment about personal responsibility. We are doing away with the category of teacher special privileges. We have found that it's problematic. Beyond this, also per the town manager's request, the policy manual includes within it revisions of job descriptions, and those are defined as currently performed in the workplace, and in consideration with current job descriptions throughout the area. Finally, we have included a personnel policy. It is designed in such a way as to supplement the town's personnel policy using the same paragraph delineations so that you can see where it fits into the town's policy. And it is an attempt to answer questions which the staff raised, which are not answered by the town's document, and to codify existing practices. If there are any questions, I would be happy to answer them, if I can.
Yes, Councilor McGinty.
I have one comment or recommendation and two questions. My first comment or recommendation on page 17 under job descriptions, and it's minor, but you list in the people there who are currently in those positions.
Yes, sir.
And that appears to be the only place you do that. It would be my recommendation to take the names out, just leave the positions, because obviously those are going to change over time, although Pat's been there for a long time and others. But just a recommendation, and only to make it consistent with the rest of the job descriptions. My questions are on page 4, under purpose, paragraph 2. It talks about library services are free to all Cape Elizabeth residents, property owners, students enrolled in Cape Elizabeth schools, all town employees, etc. And the fact that you called out students enrolled in Cape Elizabeth schools, does that have any impact on students who may be enrolled in private or parochial schools who live in town? I know free to all Cape Elizabeth residents may cover that, but the fact that you said students enrolled in Cape Elizabeth school.
Our thinking was going in the other direction, sir. I understand that teachers may bring offspring into the Cape Elizabeth school system. So we're, in essence, extending the benefit to an employee.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good idea. Maybe you should put non-resident students.
Okay.
Something to that effect, just to make that clear that it doesn't, that all students, all residents of Cape are welcome at the. And a question perhaps for the town manager. Do we charge for the use of conference room at other locations such as town hall or the community services?
We do not charge at the town hall nor at the community center. The school department does have a new policy which went into place a year ago, roughly, that Bill Jordan served on the committee and Deborah Lane that began to charge for different facilities. Effective January, we charge for the picnic shelter at Fort Williams, obviously, in Spurwing Church, but effective January 1, the community center is now being reserved through community services, as well as the picnic shelter, and it is an issue that we're going to be looking at this coming year, so that we don't have the situation where people will go to the municipal or school facility that's the least cost, that we're going to be looking for some more equity within the system. But in the meantime, this is the current policy within the library, and that we wanted to deal with that more comprehensively, looking at all the facilities and not just at the library.
Fine, thank you.
Councilor Reed.
Yes, thank you. I have a follow-up question on, or a comment on that school. Just for the record, only some staff are allowed to bring their offspring into the schools. That practice has been stopped, with only those there 3 years ago being grandfathered or their siblings. Also, on page 24, I had a question regarding conference attendance, and I was just wondering about what work time is. Is it when they arrive? Does it include travel time? I noticed on another page there's a 24-cent per mile credit for travel time on library business.
My understanding of that would be that work begins the minute that one reports to an official function in which one is functioning as a library staffer.
So they would drive to Bangor on their own time at 24 cents a mile, but at 9 o'clock.
That's my general understanding of the way that's interpreted by federal law.
Okay, thank you. And they get comp time first before overtime?
That's in keeping with the town's personnel policy. Comp time is the preference.
Thank you. And I wanted to know about lunch break. The unpaid lunch break. Can they take longer than 30 minutes if they need to?
The policy is currently written so that once a year, the staff is allowed to sit down and jointly decide as a peer group how they choose to exercise the time given to them by the town. The current understanding is that they are waiving coffee breaks in favor of a longer lunch period.
Is there a state law on if you work for 4.5 hours, you need to be off the clock 10?
I believe the state requires that time be offered, not that it be taken.
I see.
It's actually federal law under the Fair Labor Standards Act. For every 4 hours work, you're required to provide a break.
Thank you. And then just a comment, Jay, on page 27, I believe there's a typo.
That wouldn't surprise me.
Well, it's the only one I picked up. Influences, plural, I think, should be single.
Where are we?
Fifth line, F. Under the influences. It should be under the influence.
Thank you.
It's a fine job. Thank you.
Councilor Coxell.
I was going to move to accept the proposed policies contained in the policy manual presented by the library director and the trustees of Thomas Memorial Library. And I'd like to add that it's a remarkable job, and we're so glad you're with us, Jay.
Thank you.
Second, and I would ditto that also. It's excellent. Excellent.
And I would third that if it were possible. Great job.
Any further discussion? All those, Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, just that there are a couple other, I think with that motion, we will exclude the listed names from the actual policy. And there's also there's one other provision in here that mentions something that shouldn't be public information that I'll discuss with Jay later that we'll remove. I'll tell you later what it is because it's caused some serious problems.
Yeah. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Item number 133 is to consider authorizing the application to the Planning Board for the proposed Fort Williams Park Cliff Walk. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I just think it's interesting as we go through this evening. It's a very lengthy evening, but over and over we see the efforts of committees working on different projects. And this is another one of those. Jeff Manfleet, who's a former member of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and in my mind still serves as chairman until his successor is chosen, which to my knowledge hasn't occurred yet. So he is here. He's been shepherding this project on behalf of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. And Tom Emery is a consultant with Land Use Consultants and has been working with the committee, worked on the original master plan for Fort Williams Park, and is here to present the efforts that result in a plan that's taken a lot of work by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and Tom and Bob Malley and others.
Thank you. Mr. Emery, Mr. Van Fleet.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, council members. My name is Jeff Van Fleet, and as Mr. McGovern said, I'm the immediate past chairman of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. The purpose for our gathering here tonight on this agenda item is to review a recommendation that we made via letter to the council late last month regarding a request for you to give your preliminary approval to a plan to construct a shore walk or cliff walk. We haven't baptized it yet. Perhaps that'll be at an appropriate time to be constructed basically along the lines of an existing footpath along the shore of Fort Williams, beginning somewhere near the Portland headlight and extending north and then west. The project is recommended basically for two reasons. And I'll just outline those policy reasons, and then Tom Emery from Land Use Consultants can address some of the more technical procedures and issues that we went through to arrive at this point. We started this about 18 months ago. Actually, it was a summer more than 18 months ago in 1995 when a very generous citizen of Cape Elizabeth approached the town manager and others with an offer to provide some funding if we would consider improving the existing walkway along the very breathtaking viewpoint walk along the shore north of the headlight. We started this project by considering what kind of a walk should be constructed, where it should be. We were very cognizant of the fact that it would be a very sensitive project and require a lot of eyes looking at it over time. We're at the point now where it has received preliminary approval. Perhaps that's too mild a term, but I think perhaps resounding approval from the Accessibility Committee. We're at the point now where with land use consultants' efforts, we have a project that I think we would like your approval to take this to the next step. Perhaps referring that to other town committees for their comment, approval, and review. Along those lines as well, at the same time, we will continue an effort to procure private funding for this project to supplement the generous offer that has already been made. Hopefully you've had a chance to look at the materials that were forwarded with my letter of December. I'll remain here to answer questions. So if you don't have any more general policy questions of me, I'd like to turn it over to Tom Emery to give you an idea of what went behind this from a technical and compliance standpoint, viewpoint.
Are there any questions for Mr. Van Fleet this time? Thank you, Chair.
Great. Thank you, Tom.
I don't know that there's a lot to say. The materials covered fairly well. I guess I'll summarize and say it's a 4-foot wide path. We've endeavored to make it as accessible as possible, but keeping, of course, the priority of the rustic nature of the site as top priority. And that was reviewed with the Accessibility Committee and was fully endorsed. We're looking at draft federal guidelines for accessibility. These are not law yet, and they're serving as a basis for the layout. I was at the site yesterday. It was probably one of the more challenging luge runs in Greater Portland, certainly more challenging than Yarmouth. There's particularly under icy conditions, extremely dangerous condition exists along the cliff face where there are winding walks, but the only thing between the edge of a walk and the water is ice, and that's one of the things that we'd like to do here. We'd like to invite more people to enjoy this walk, but at the same time maintain it in a very rustic and safer condition. There was a question with respect to the construction materials. We're looking at several, but let me say for the public, it's not our intent at all to have this a paved walkway unless we can find a material that is suitable and similar to the aggregates that are existing naturally on the cliff face. We're looking at a couple of alternatives, one of which is essentially a Metamucil product, which takes a very small aggregate and binds it together. It's a natural product. Provides some maintenance. It's been fully reviewed by the Public Works Director, who's expressed concerns about its availability. It's in massive quantities, but it's also comes from the Southwest. It has been used in Battery Park in New York City and has been used in Canada, so it's both been exposed to high traffic conditions as well as similar climatic conditions. With that, if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. I can remember a couple of years ago, the town manager, Jack Roberts, on the Conservation Commission, and I walked along this when we were first made aware of the contribution. And it was so wonderful to think this would eventually come to fruition. And I applaud both of you and the Fort Williams Commission for getting this to where we are today. It's going to be a safe place for people to walk. You said breathtaking, and there were a couple of instances, and I'm sure there were in the icy conditions, it was almost more than breathtaking. It's a fantastic part of the fort where not everybody has been aware of, and will open up some wonderful new experiences and some new vistas for people. I'm excited that we can move it along. Anybody else? Councilor Jordan.
I'd just like to ask where this walk is going to be. Has the storms recently eroded any of the shore?
That was specifically the reason I went to the site yesterday. I didn't see any evidence of water touching any of the areas of the walk where we're proposing. While we're down near the water, we continue to be on top of the cliff face or ledge, so we're above the direct impact of the waves. We had unusually high tides this past week, but I wouldn't consider that to be a winter hurricane condition. So there may be areas that might be susceptible to salt spray, but there was no indication, and I know there was a very large wash over Shore Road with a storm. There were no indications of what I look for were washouts of the ice and snow that would have been hit by salt water, and the only indications I saw along the entire path was a freshly fallen snow with a glaze ice on top.
So one more question, if I may. So where you got this walk earmarked and you feel that there's a chance for some erosion before it would have to be changed, is there any? There might be a storm come along in another 5 years or so that might nip at it a little bit. So it's going to be in enough, so it could be.
It's generally in somewhere around as little as 5 feet and as much as 8 or 10 feet and even further or farther in from the existing walk, depending upon the location and the topography. It's certainly areas that we have identified in the past where there have been a complete undercutting of the existing trail are now actually gone. The trail collapsed within that. We're well above those locations. The alignment of the path, I should note, was very much a commission and committee effort. The entire commission was there with the public works director, and we literally slashed our way through brush and set flags, and then those flags were surveyed. So I wouldn't make any promises with respect to what the ocean can do at Fort Williams, but from everything I've observed and relative to the topo and the flood tides, there's nothing that indicates that there would be any wash of flood over the trails.
Thank you.
Councilor Linnell.
I hope you wouldn't make a prediction of the ocean.
Councilor Linnell.
Yes, thank you. Just a quick question. You made reference to accessibility. Is there any place on there that the handicapped would have a shot at it?
What we've done is used federal accessibility guidelines for recreation facilities. This is a trail. It's not going to follow the typical accessibility guidelines of a 1 in 12 slope for 30 feet with a 5-foot landing. What we've done is met general criteria that says that out of this entire trail, a certain percentage can have 14% slopes. Certain percentage can be 8% slopes. The reason that it's that liberal is that the critical nature here is preserving the existing environment without going ahead and putting in a lot of concrete abutments and switchbacks and all the rest of those structures that would be necessary. Quite frankly, if it had to be fully accessible to that extent, it would probably it would be to the loss of the enjoyment of the natural character of the
right.
trail.
But there are places at either end or something.
Yes,
get out there in a small section.
That's correct. At both trailheads, at the north end and the south end, there'll be signage that identifies the nature of the accessibility, the percent of slopes as relative to the entire trail length. In addition, along the trail length, depending upon our final design, there'll be switch-out areas where people can rest and where there'll be flatter areas for people to rest. But there's many levels of accessibility. There's many capabilities. For instance, people compete in the Boston Marathon. I'm fully capable of walking, but I'm not capable of competing in the Boston Marathon. But there are people who are unable to walk who can. And they look for challenges that might be presented on this trail. The critical thing is that it's signed and identified in advance.
Great. Thank you.
Anybody else? Councilor Cogsell.
I just want to add that they did spend an hour and a half with the ADA committee and Gail Parker in December with large-scale maps, and she had catalogs of different kinds of equipment so you could determine what would be accessible for different types of accessory aids in different areas, as well as the signage.
It would be, I don't know if it would spoil the design at all, but I think one thing that would be nice if there was one place where a van could drive up so that someone who is not likely to get out of the van can still have a look at the ocean. And the reason I mention that is because I've personal experience. There's one place by the lighthouse where you can do that, but when you drive up there, there's this big handicap sign right in your view, and so you have the lighthouse here and this big sign right in the middle of your view, and I think that's unfortunate.
That would be the space that would be utilized for that. There are two handicap parking spaces or accessible parking spaces at the lighthouse, and this trail would connect through that sidewalk system.
Thank you. Councilor Groff.
I would like to make a motion to authorize an application of the Planning Board for the proposed cliff walk at Fort Williams Park.
Second.
Thank you. Further discussion?
Yes.
Councilor
I have one
Terry.
More comment as far as on the ocean side. What are your plans? There is a fence, a rail fence, or
we've discussed this at some length. The concern we have is that this is anything that's done down in this cliff face is what, I'm not an attorney, but might be considered an attractive nuisance. And I have evidence from last summer of families who allow children completely unescorted who are under the age of 12 to venture out onto the rocks. People behave in any number of ways when they're in recreation settings, and particularly as they get closer to water, none of which do I feel comfortable that we can design against all circumstances. There may be some unusual areas out there where we're extremely close to the cliff edge where we might recommend putting a rail, but generally what we'd prefer to do is to move the trail away from the cliff face, fill in the existing eroded path with the material that we're removing to construct a new path, and essentially leave people to their own devices. One recommendation that the Accessibility Committee had is if we end up in some steeper sections of trail, it may be helpful to put some sort of a handrail up. But I think if one takes a very close look at that, anything going on in Fort Williams, short of doing what's done at the lighthouse where there's a continuous chain link fence, I think it's going to be very difficult not to find many, many places along this cliff face that would need fairly elaborate restraint. Concern we have that once we get into that, it requires that there be no opening greater than 4 inches in any type of separation, and that the separation at least be 42 inches high.
Okay, thank you.
All right, all those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you, gentlemen. Item number 134 is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee about the Fort Williams Park open space. Councilor Jordan?
I have a copy here of what we call to the Fort Williams Master Plan, which had policy 2 and 3, which is the open areas along the water. And we redone 2 and 3 and took out the nice wood as permanently, and we replaced it with the woods that we used at the last meeting with the last goal, with the goals to emphasize for current and future town council that the eerie respectable scene, natural and historic qualities of Fort Williams should be potentially preserved. The town council does hereby create and dedicate the national area in Fort Williams Park. And there we have a policy here to dedicate the back down by the lighthouse, the green area, as I call it, that goes towards Delano Park, and also a policy with the same wording to start with that does the area along the shore that we've been discussing, and also over by the guarded mansion. And I don't know anything. I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'll turn it over to Michael if you feel it should be read.
Yeah.
At this point, I don't think I'll do it. This hour of the game.
Thank you.
So if there's any comment, glad to hear from him.
Thank you, Councillor Jordan. Councillor McGinty.
I move that we set a public hearing on the proposed amendment to the Fort Williams Master Plan for February 10th, 1997, at 7:30 p.m. at the Cape Elizabeth Town Hall, with proper notice thereof.
Second.
Any comments or discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 135 is to consider setting a public hearing for March 12, 1997, on the proposed zoning ordinance. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, I'm very pleased to report that the Planning Board has forwarded their comments on the zoning ordinance rewrite. They made a couple of minor changes, which Maureen has indicated to you what they affect. Really pleased that we've reached this point. Do want to talk a little bit about procedure. You have this before you this evening. You have established an evening to discuss some of the scenic views, scenic vistas aspect of this on the 24th of February. And then there's the issue of, you know, when are you going to be looking to finally adopt this? The original intent was that you'd have a public hearing in March and then one in April. The staff believes that at the March meeting it is important to revisit the appropriateness of whether or not April or May is more appropriate, simply because of the noticing requirements under the state law for amending zoning ordinances and having make sure there's all the proper notices with any changes you wish to make. So it's really important that as you review this, that if you are going to make changes, that we know about them really pretty close to the March council meeting, because if you are going to make changes, they've got to be put into form with plenty of notice and people having the right to access it so that you could adopt it at a subsequent meeting. And it needs to be, unlike most ordinance amendments, where there needs to be a 1 week notice, with zoning under state law, there needs to be 2 weeks notice. I just wanted to caution you that there may be a slight change from what you heard previously as to when hearings might be, but it's still possible in April, but it depends on what your inclination is to change what is now in this yellow book. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. I also recall we have the strong potential for two council meetings in May.
That's
correct.
That's correct.
So
you'll be having
potentially it could be on the first or second of the on one of those.
I was just whispering to the council chairman. I hope it's the second, since this is long and detailed and I won't be here.
Tom's here.
Does he want to say something?
Mr. Emery, do you have any thoughts you'd like to share with us? And tell us what capacity you're speaking in, please, so I don't ask you to sit down.
Chairman Parkhurst requested that I appear in his stead this evening, and as a gift to the outgoing chair, I'm very pleased to do that. I think what I'll just say, the truth is self-evident. We've really only commented on the procedural issues and made clarifications with respect to contract zoning. I think it serves well to state that this has been very much a collaborative effort of all the town boards, and we've all worked very closely together on this. So as we come to this point in the process, there isn't a lot more to add. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Could entertain a motion, please. Councilor Cogswell.
I move that we set a public hearing on March 12, 1997 at 7:30 p.m. at Cape Elizabeth Town Hall on the proposed zoning ordinance.
Thank you.
And with proper please, notice thereof.
Please note that is a Wednesday meeting in March.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 137 is to consider a proposal from the City of South Portland to perambulate the municipal boundary. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, there have been many famous perambulations in history. Lewis and Clark comes to mind. A number of others in Roman times. Under Maine law, communities are required with their neighbors to perambulate their boundaries once every 5 years. It's pretty apparent that the last time it was done between Cape Elizabeth and South Portland was in 1948, which
is a little bit more than 5 years. This came to the attention of the communities when there's a development that is right on the South Portland Cape Elizabeth line that has its property line described as the town line. And there's a question as to what angle from a certain monument the town line goes, and there's a dispute as to which way it goes. I've had a number of discussions with Jeff Jordan about this. He suggested, and since the law reads every 5 years, I couldn't disagree with him, he suggested we perambulate the whole boundary. The current estimated cost for that is $21,500. Under state law, the cost would be equally divided between the two communities. The way this would work is we'd go out and have a consultant do most of the work. South Portland is recommending Owen Haskell, who has a lot of experience in this area. And then ultimately, under the law, the council is supposed to go out there and walk it once you know, we do a little bit more work. So you're probably the most famous perambulation since Lewis and Clark, but you'd be doing that with the South Portland City Council. And our hope is to get this done sometime during the summer. South Portland has not yet, as yet, acted on this, and I'm unsure when they might be acting.
After, excuse me.
Councilor Jordan, go ahead. Yes.
I hope we're going to, I'd like to walk it myself. I think I could make it, unless you want to do it all in one day or something like that.
It's only 5 miles.
But this is going to be after Owen Haskell does his work, so there's going to be a nice pass so we don't get switched in the face as we walk along. Is that correct?
My sense is that I think you'll come to some agreement as to the areas that you really need to fully walk. I don't think you'd be expected to walk all 4 miles in its entirety. So if there are sensitive areas, yeah, we would clear those away. But it could be quite traumatic to everyone if we went out and cleared swaths in a lot of people's yards. And you know, we wouldn't be intending to do that or ask them to take down fences so you could walk through.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Reed.
Maybe we could get some of those snowmobilers to give you a ride.
It's going to be done in the summer.
I had a question. Michael, is the cost $21,500 because we haven't had this done in 50 years? Or would that be our estimated cost every 5 years, and should we be budgeting for it?
That would be virtually every, you know, it'd be a little bit less because of the amount of monuments. But, you know, if you had any surveying done, I was surprised it was this low. You know, this also begs the issue of sometime we need to have a discussion with Scarborough about the same issue. It's not as much of an issue, but we do share a boundary with them as well.
Is this an unfunded state mandate?
Excuse me?
Is this considered an unfunded state mandate?
You could call it. Yeah, the state does not fund this cost, and they do require it to be done, yes.
I can't wait to see you walk on water when you do the Scarborough boundary. Councilor Coxall.
I move to cooperate with the City of South Portland to perambulate the boundary between the two communities and to split the estimated cost of $21,500 with the Town of Cape Elizabeth's share to come from the undesignated surplus account.
Second.
Thank you. Councilor McGinty.
I won't be supporting this motion. I think that if for 50 years we haven't had to do this, that unless somebody's pushing us to do it, we shouldn't have to do it. If I'm all willing to do whatever we have to do to help out the homeowner here, delineate his boundary of his property, but to do the rest of it, where we haven't been required to do it for 50 years, is a waste of $10,000 if you ask me, and I won't support this.
Councilor Coxall.
I think we should approach our representatives in the legislature and see if, in this day and age with GPS and everything else, if we really need to do this every 5 years. I could see back in the colonial days perhaps, but I think we need to perhaps take this one step further and talk to our representatives about changing the state law.
Mm-hmm. Mr. McGovern, I had a question. I'm curious how this fits in with the current GIS work being undertaken.
This would go into, you know, we would get the new stations, monumentation, we would then enter those into our GIS system to ensure more accuracy within our GIS system. The other issue, you know, with this is that since 1948, an awful lot has gone on along the boundary, particularly in the western part of South Portland, or what we think is the western part of South Portland. Jeff Jordan, the city manager of South Portland, mentioned to me that he thinks there may even be a house on one street in South Portland that is actually in Cape Elizabeth. So, you know, there, and that has nothing to do with the property owner who is pushing for this to be done. So there may be some issues out there that need to be looked at.
I need to second what the manager has just said, having some familiarity with that part of South Portland. And not at all to alarm anybody, but I think we'd be well served to have some very accurate information about this municipal boundary line. Councilor Lanell.
Yeah, I just think it would, I think we'd be well served to know where our boundary is. And I think as soon as we do that, we can plug it into the GIS effort. So I would tend to support it.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
I'll yield to the lady.
Councilor Reed.
I think she had a...
I was just wondering, could we say up to 21.5, half of 21.5, instead of supporting the whole number in case it's less? And what if it's more?
If it's more, we'll come back and ask for more money. Yep. But I'm willing to change my motion to say up to.
Thank you.
Is a second?
Second.
Consent?
Sure.
Okay. Up to. Councilor Jordan.
No, I just feel this should be done, because I know one area here, and I don't think there's really any boundaries laid out there. When you up on Sawyer Road up there, and there's a house that was partly in Scarborough and partly in Cape Elizabeth, due to, because there's a rock on top of the hill which is 2 inches thick, and it's leaning to the west. And I think that should be found. But in the meantime, what we had done, we had made agreement with Scarborough that still letting that house be partly taxed in Cape Elizabeth and Scarborough,
right,
that we moved the boundary down,
right,
with some descriptions to the river, or the Spoic Marsh, I think that's the Spoic River. So I think there's some work ought to be done to get clarified for the future.
Thank you. All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 6-1. Mr. Councilor McGinty in opposition? Thank you. Item number 138 is to consider a report from the Appointments Committee about vacancies on boards and commissions and committees. Councilor Reed.
Yes, I'm very pleased to present to the Town Council the names of Pamela McNally and Jack Roberts as the at-large members. And I'm also asking that a woman that we just appointed to another commission, if we would approve the Arts Commission appointee of Marsha Wiggins. And I've just been...
Is that a motion from the Appointments Committee?
All right.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor of the Appointments Committee?
Oh, just these two.
Just these two, right.
Just, what, yep. Just the Appointments Committee motion.
Okay.
Right. Mm-hmm. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. What the Council has just received is the composition, the complete composition of the Poor Farm Study Committee. With this motion, we have Pamela McNally, Jack Roberts, two citizens at large, Randy Blake representing the Land Trust, Donald Evans representing the Conservation Commission, Thomas Emery representing the Planning Board, Councilor Cogsell representing the Council, and myself representing the Council. There will be no ex officio capacity. Councilor Jordan.
I don't quite agree with Councilor Coggeshall being on the committee, where she's on the committee of the Poor Farm Trust. Is that correct?
There's no conflict there, being on the trust committee.
I think there could be a very good conflict.
Why, when the
and,
town...
And I think the chairman of the council should be an ex officio, and we have another council member on.
Councilor Jordan, that's an interesting comment. You were, the last time we discussed this, you seemed concerned that there would be an overabundance of council influence with two councilors as committee members and the council chairman as ex officio. Actually, that's one thing I took into consideration when I decided I would be a regular member instead of an ex officio member, thereby cutting the council, the number of councilors involved, to two rather than three.
Well, to answer that, I will go with the same issue as far as Councilor Coggeshall is concerned. And as far as yourself as chairman, I still think that you should represent the town as an ex officio like we have in the past with other committees. And I would like to see on there, and I think there's some new blood and maybe some different thinking. And I hope Council Goff will take a shot at it.
Thank you. Anybody else? Council
I have a question, maybe a point of order or not. We just voted on just the two people for the Poor Farm Study Committee. Is that correct?
Right. The two that were appointed by, recommended by the Appointments
right.
Committee.
And we still have to do the Arts Commission. Is that?
No, we, Councilor Reed's motion was Pam McNally and Jack Roberts for the Poor Farm Study Committee and Marsha Wiggins for the Arts Commission.
Okay.
And that was approved.
Okay. All right. That's fine. I misunderstood.
Sure, I'm sorry.
It doesn't affect my vote. I just misunderstood.
I should have. I apologize for creating a confusion on that.
When you said just those two, I thought you were talking about the two for the Poor Farm, not the two different committees. That's fine. I'm also.
It's late. Anybody else? Councillor Malone, I'm sorry. I'm tired.
It's hard to do this tonight.
Well, I think Councillor Jordan's point about Councillor Coggeshall being on both the Poor Farm Study Committee and the Thomas Jordan Trust, I think I could clarify that a little. The trust now has only concerns the money that's in the trust. So the Thomas Jordan Trust has nothing to do with the Poor Farm land anymore. So on that particular point, my sense is that there's no conflict there because one really doesn't have anything to do with the other now. It's just the money. It's just the money, which and as far as the needs or concerns of the poor in the town, they have nothing to do with that property anymore. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Groff.
I appreciate Councillor Jordan suggesting that I be on the Poor Farm Study Committee, and I would certainly be willing to do that. I would say, though, that the way I understand how these committees get staffed is the chair makes those decisions, and I certainly have no quarrel with the chair making the decision as she did. I would volunteer to be on it, but at the same time, I am not in any way contesting the appropriateness of the chair making the appointments as she sees fit, because I think that's just a procedural mechanism that we should respect.
Anybody else? Councilor Jordan.
No, I just want to say, kind of answer to Councilor Linnell's comments is that I know it's a separated issue, but to me, it's the same parcel of land with two names, and it's closer than maybe you think, but it's closer to me as a conflict.
Councilor McGinty?
As the other member of the Jordan Trust committee, I would say that I don't see it as a conflict either. I think that there's no connection. I agree completely with what Councilor Linnell said, that there is no connection at this time, except by name only. and I see no conflict, so I can support Councillor Coggeshall being on the committee.
Okay, thank you. This is not something that is up for a council vote. The appointments are made by the council chairman, and at this point, I would say I'm going to change the composition by one member, and Councillor Graff will replace Councillor McLaughlin. Thank you. Item number 139 is to consider entering executive session to discuss land acquisition and or disposition, a request for a poverty abatement, upcoming negotiations for the Cape Elizabeth Police Benevolent Association, and the town manager's annual evaluation. All those are potential discussion items.
So moved.
We will.
Second.
But do we want to take an item out of order?
I don't think so.
Citizen discussion.
We will not be coming back for any votes this evening in public session. Therefore, if there's anybody in the audience who would like to take advantage of the citizens' discussion period, would they please come to the podium? It's so funny to say that to one person. You have nothing to say to us this evening, sir? All right. The meeting will be adjourned immediately after executive session. We will not need the television cameras after we go into executive session. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, one of the issues that you may be discussing in executive session is a poverty abatement. And if